Hi guys, welcome to Cryptids Canada. I hope everybody's enjoying their day so far. So before I get started, can somebody, anybody, tell me what the heck happened to YouTube? I am not even kidding. It took me forever to figure out how to upload the video. It takes me double the time to answer your comments or to just put that little heart. I gotta hit the heart button and then it takes me to a menu and then I gotta hit heart. And it's like ridiculous. Hit the heart button. That's all I used to have to do. I am not a really complex kind of person. Once I get it, then I get it. But trying to figure it out, oh my gosh, getting a new cell phone for me is horrifying. So forgive me, guys. It's going to take a little while to get used to this. And if I don't put a little heart beside your comment or comment on your comment, it's not that I didn't read it. It's just such a pain in the neck. Oh, yeah. And the community section is gone. I wanted to put a note up on the community section, you know, letting you know I'm going to be a little late because of this baloney, to put it nicely. Anyways, guys. On with chapter 15. There was no quiet morning coffee for me today. The whole house was up, electrified at the crack of dawn. Lisa was running around like a chicken with no head. It was like she was putting on a whole affair, rifling through boxes, looking for extra carafes so we had plenty of coffee. I was getting more and more irritated by the moment. I was angry the weekend was ruined, and I felt bad for Gwen and Jerry. Some relaxing weekend, when Lisa came through the kitchen door with not one carafe but two. I snapped. I cornered her and I asked her what she was doing. "I'm making sure we have plenty of coffee ready. We don't even know how many people are coming this morning," Lisa answered. "Do you know how ridiculous you sound? You're acting like you have personally invited these people for breakfast. And I might remind you that you were more than a little pissed off last night when Sheriff Martin didn't even have the decency to mention it to us, that people were going to be traipsing all over our land and probably parking in our driveway." At that point, I had to stop and take a deep breath. I had to use every ounce of air in my lungs to make my point. Lisa stood staring at me, and the whole kitchen fell silent. I think someone even turned the TV down too. I had never spoken to her in that manner, especially around other people. I was embarrassed by my outburst and was just going to apologize when Lisa said, "You're right. I lost my footing a bit. This isn't our affair. It should be the county giving people coffee." "I guess I just wanted to help," she said, as her eyes filled with tears. I pulled her close to me and told her how sorry I was. She was kind-hearted and always wanted to help, and that was a quality about her that I loved. I was just so mad at the way Sheriff Martin had been treating us and now disrespecting us that I took it out on her. As I kissed away the tear that fell down her cheek, we heard Brianna say, "Mom and Dad, you better come and look at this." We all filled out of the kitchen and went to the big living room window where Brianna was standing. Lisa and I were the last to get to the window. Kathy and Jerry stepped aside to let us have room to look out our window. The only way to describe what I was seeing was, "You have got to be kidding." And because I was seeing it with my own eyes, I couldn't even say that. Sheriff Martin was personally directing traffic on my front lawn. At 7:45, he had already 9 cars parked in 2 rows right on my front lawn. That was the last straw. I headed to the back door to get my shoes, and Scott said, "Wait up, Brad, I'm coming with you." As we walked down the driveway towards the sheriff, Scott said, "Brad, please just don't hit him, okay?" I was so mad that I really was capable of hitting him right in that moment. But I was glad that Scott brought it up and made me aware that I had to keep that in check. We were about 10 feet from the sheriff when he turned in our direction. When he realized it was us, he put his hand up and actually said, Not now, Monero. I got to get these folks parked so we can get out on time. I was sick with fury when I got in front of him. Who the heck do you think you are? I yelled. This is my land. You don't even ask if you can park half the friggin' town on my front lawn, and you tell me not now? Watch it, boy, he said between clenched teeth. I can arrest you right now if I want to. Just go back into your house, and I'll come and get you if I need you. No, I don't think so. And on what grounds are you going to arrest me? I continued to yell. I can't speak for all these people, but it's my opinion that you are a bully who throws your weight around. I've called you for help several times, and you have done nothing for me. And now you think you're going to come out here and use my front lawn as a parking lot without even asking me? No, Sheriff, I don't think so. He's right, Sheriff, you know. You have no grounds to arrest this man, and you actually decided to use his front lawn as a parking lot without his permission. Seems to me he has grounds to lay charges on you if he chooses to, said Detective Lewis. I've got more than 70 people coming out for this search, and where would you like to park them? Sheriff Martin barked at Detective Lewis. Well, now, I suppose I would have had them meet at the courthouse, and I would have bussed them in. But that's only my way of thinking, seeing there's no parking all the way out here, Detective Lewis hissed back at the sheriff. I felt a hand on my shoulder, and I turned to look, and it was Will Johansson. Son, can I have a word with you? He asked quietly. Yeah, Will, how are you doing? I'm okay, son. Listen, I know that what the sheriff did to you was wrong. I'm mad, too. But there are a lot of really good folks here that gave up their Sunday church to come out and help. What do you say that we let them park here, and I'll come over later in the week, and I'll help you repair the damage done? Let's just say it's for the greater good. When you put it like that, Will, how can I say no? Will gave his head a quick nod and walked back to where a very large crowd was gathering. Listen up, folks. Our good neighbor here, Brad Monero, has agreed to let us park on his front lawn, even though no one thought to ask his permission. So make sure when you leave out of here today, you drive slowly and carefully so as not to ruin his lawn, yelled Will. People responded by waving and nodding their appreciation. Some even came up and shook my hand and introduced themselves. I had to admit, I ended up feeling pretty good. As Scott and I made our way back up to the house, I turned around and happened to notice the sheriff was still standing in the same spot, glaring at me. I smiled and gave him a quick nod, continued on my way back to the house. We only had time to finish our coffee when it was time to go back out and join the search. Gwen and Lisa were staying at the house to have their visit. Lisa was going to give Gwen a lesson in milking goats. True to his word, there was about 70 people who showed up for the search. Detective Lewis separated us into groups of 10. Each group was given a walkie-talkie and a GPS with coordinates for that group. We were basically told that we were looking for any sign of a vagrant living in the woods. If anyone actually saw someone or evidence of a vagrant, we were to walkie it in. Kathy, Scott, Jerry, and I were in a group with Will and Rhett and four other men. Our group was going straight back through the pasture, past the pond. At least I would get to see more of my land. As we passed the barn, I looked back and I noticed the barn doors were open. So I ran back and I shut it, thinking it must have gotten left open in the commotion yesterday afternoon. We were able to complete the search area we were given in about 4 hours. We were thankful it was a nice day, so it wasn't hot out, but we kept our spirits up by bantering back and forth. I discovered I had some really nice wooded property. Scott and I pointed out the tree structures that we had noticed on our first hunting trip. Everyone was really amazed by them. One guy in particular, I think he said his name was Harvey, said that they had not been made by humans, but by a clan of bush people. After that, he wouldn't elaborate, so we just let the subject drop. we really didn't see any sign of vagrants living all the way out here, so we felt pretty good on our way back to the house. I'm going to have a long bath when we get back, said Kathy. Oh, can I watch? Asked Scott. Scott, your dad can hear you, whispered Kathy. I can hear him too, Rut bellowed jokingly. Oh, to be young again. I'm going to eat a cow and then take a long nap, I said. I'm really pooped. The loud squawking of a walkie interrupted our joking around. Command base to Will Johansson. Will looked up, just as surprised as the rest of us, as he unclipped the walkie from his waistband. Will Johansson here, he responded. Will, are you with Brad Monero? Asked the voice on the other end, who I thought was Detective Lewis. Yeah, he's right here, answered Will. How far out are you, Will? Not far. We can see the house, answered Will. Okay, good. See you soon, then. Over and out. Okay, bye, said Will. I was shocked. He asked Will if he was with me. I really didn't like the feeling I was getting. I looked at Jerry and Scott, and it was obvious they felt the same. I'm going to take off, I said. I'll see you guys back at the house. I took off running as fast as I could and wasn't the least bit surprised that almost everyone from the group kept up with me. When we got close to the barn, we slowed down. I wasn't a spring chicken anymore. I could jog, but sprinting as fast as I can could only get me so far. I scanned the back of the house. My eyes came to rest on Lisa and Gwen sitting on the steps at the back deck and Detective Lewis leaning over talking to them. When I was almost to the deck, I yelled out, is everything okay? Lisa and Gwen looked up surprised to see us all so close. They both jumped up. Detective Lewis backed off to make room for them. Both women came running towards us. Gwen flew into Jerry's arms and Lisa into mine. Both women sobbed uncontrollably as all of us kept asking what happened, what's going on. Finally, Detective Lewis came over to where we all stood and said, Brad, Jerry, the ladies here went to milk the goats and happened upon a pretty gruesome sight, and they're obviously upset. What did they find? I asked. Lisa stammered that Wilbur, the pot-bellied pig, was ripped apart and the goats were both missing. What? Asked Jerry. Something ate half of the pig, sobbed Gwen. There's blood and guts everywhere. Jerry, I want to go home. And I want you, Lisa, the kids, and Scott to come home with us. It's not safe here, Brad. Don't you see it? She sobbed. I know it's upsetting, Gwen, I said as I held on to Lisa. But we live in the country now, and sometimes there are predators that are looking for an easy meal. I noticed this morning the barn doors in the back got left open in the commotion yesterday. Something's gotten in and got the pig and the goats and probably took off out of fear. I'm sure they'll be back soon, I said. Brad, can I have a minute with you? Detective Lewis motioned me over, away from everyone else. I walked over to where he was standing. It's always something, I murmured. I hear you, Brad. Listen, I didn't want to say anything in front of everyone else because I know they're all upset. But I have to be on the road. The search brought up no suspects, so I've been called on to another assignment. I want to give you my card. It's got my personal cell on it. I want you to call me and keep me informed of any other strange occurrences, okay? I won't be here, but I can maybe help. Who knows, right? He sighed. I wish they'd give me another day or two, but you know how the government works. I understand, John. I appreciate your help and friendship. When are you leaving? I asked. Right now, he answered wearily. I'll let you tell the family when it's better timing, okay? He said as he reached out and shook my hand. Then he turned and headed around the corner towards the front yard. We all went inside as the last of the searchers were coming back. I didn't want to get stuck in a conversation with someone I didn't really know. I really needed to sleep, and I was a little relieved that Gwen and Jerry were heading out. Too much was going on, and I needed to get a grip on things. We all said our goodbyes and walked Gwen and Jerry to their car. As they pulled down the driveway, Scott leaned over and whispered, Gwen really did her damnedest to convince us to leave, huh? Oh, yeah, I agreed. She's a worrier. Plus, Lisa is her baby sister. But you know, Scott, if you're having thoughts about leaving, I wouldn't blame you. Are you kidding, Brad? I love it here. It gets a little weird sometimes, but I can handle it, replied Scott. I was more than a little relieved to hear him say that. I had come to rely on Scott. He was a good kid and a good friend. Scott and Kathy went to their apartment, and Lisa and I took the kids and went into the house. We made it to the living room, where each of us found a seat and fell into it. One more week of summer and the kids would be starting school, I thought. Hopefully that would provide a nice routine and some normalcy. Brad, I forgot to tell you, with all the craziness that went on today, your mom and dad called, said Lisa. Oh, nice, I answered. What's new with them? Well, I guess you can talk to them yourselves when they get here next weekend, she said, with an intentionally phony smile on her face. I just stared at her. I couldn't even fathom the idea of another weekend. Well, at least I had a week to try to get life back on track and spend some time with my wife and kids. And that is the end of chapter 15. So guys, it's been a long day. I think that I'm going to stop there. I'm going to edit this and get it up so you guys have a video for the morning. Okay, bye for now.